well laid out.
Logical.
That describes the desk.
The room.
Or, frankly, the kind of life that we strive for.
We have a desire to keep things organized.
As the classic saying goes,
a place for everything and everything in its place.
This week's book bucks that conventional wisdom.
Instead of pushing for organized lives,
it claims that our finest moments can emerge from disorder.
In fact, a healthy dose of chaos can help us better reach our potential.
So let's jump right into Tim Hartford's book, Messy, The Power of Disorder to Change Our Lives. Welcome back. You're listening to Motivation Minute, where we unravel the timeless truths in that stack of books you've been wanting to read so that you don't have to. This week's book is Messy, The Power of Disorder to Change Our Lives by Tim Hartford. You know, Jiraiya, this was an interesting book because I came at the book thinking, oh, messy, disorder. I'm like the antithesis of disorder, well, in some respects. I like organization.
Definitely.
But this book is like against organization.
Yeah, it's interesting. It actually talks about how being unorganized and messy is actually good in some ways to inspire creativity. You know, like you talked about how your desk doesn't have to be completely organized. If there was nothing on your desk, you wouldn't even be able to work. Or it's like, it's good to have some things, some piles of papers on your desk. I think there's a balance. But he talked about how it's okay to be messy.
Well, on the thought of that desk thing, he brought up how if you get too organized, you spend all your time organizing and less getting the right work done. And he brought up this example of using stacks of paper, where if you just keep everything in stacks, the most important stuff stays at the top because you keep referencing it. And then every once in a while, you can toss out the bottom of the stack because you never were looking at that.
Right.
It's like the poor man's way of not organizing and just hacking their way to, you know, having semi-organization.
Right. You brought up some really good points in the book. But for me, the message from the book is something that I could definitely learn from it, like the good points that he made. But it's like, in some ways, I feel like I already do this stuff to an extreme to where it becomes unbalanced the other way naturally in my life. Like he talked about this study where where a professor, I think of some type of a teacher, analyzed kids that were going to university or school, and he found that the ones that were very unfocused and had, like, you know, ADHD or whatever, not actually ADHD, but if they were very unfocused and they wouldn't concentrate on one thing at a time, they were kind of unorganized, those were the most creative people that were more likely to have, you know, written a novel or whatever, or done art or some other creative endeavors, you know, successful creative endeavors. And it's because they, like you gave the example of people who aren't good at filtering out noise in a conversation when you're talking to one person and there's other people talking. People who are actually bad at concentrating and who can't help but being distracted by the other noise in the room. For some reason, those people are the most creative people because they notice chaos or they notice random things happening. You know, they're not just like structured and focused on one thing. They allow for creativity in their personality, apparently.
That's an interesting point about how creativity is stronger when you have like randomness. That was part of my number one takeaway from this book, that when you leave things a little bit messy, you are more creative because that randomness inspires you in ways you didn't expect. Because random, by its very nature, is something that you can't plan around. And so if your life is cluttered in a sense with like a lot of different directions you're torn between, or your job or your business that you're running, and you don't have it all in perfect order, what's interesting is having a little bit of disorder lets certain things that you wouldn't normally plan around come in that change you and catapult you to the next place.
Right. I can see how it's so useful to be, if you're the type of person that is just structured and does the same thing and doesn't like to be surprised, how that can just become stagnant and go nowhere, you know. if it gets old and routine. Like, I think it has to do a lot of with personality, like people who are unorganized in their personality. Like, I was actually diagnosed with ADHD or something when I was a kid, and I'm still that way, kind of, where I'm kind of a chaos monkey, if you want to call me that, where it's like, you know, I like to be surprised. I like just random things to happen. And I didn't realize this for a long time that I was this way, but I naturally am the type that just goes by, you know, moment to moment. And I don't spend time planning, organizing, thinking ahead. And I mean, I just naturally don't do that. And that, I think that can cause problems, you know, being too much like that. You know, it's also helped me in my creativity, being very creative naturally, I guess. But I'm trying at this point in my life to become more organized and to be, you know, to kind of do the opposite of that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the complete opposite because, you know, I'm Mr. Organized with, you know, we type up our notes and I've got everything lined up with the headings and everything's bolded or colored with a certain code I use for what's priority to talk about on an episode. But the thing is, if you're too organized like me, you don't leave room for improvisation in the middle, which is what the benefit you get is, because you'll go moment to moment and things will strike you that will take you off a complete tangent that's the complete right way to go, versus me, I'm locked into, here's what I planned that I thought would be good talking points. And then I'm like, you know, just going down the list and seeing where it goes versus staying open to like one point being all we talk about. And that only.
Right. Some random different things that you didn't expect. Right.
Yeah. Like disruption for me is something I do not like. And actually the book brought up an example of a disruption for London commuters when the tube closed for 2 days when the workers went on strike. And there was this interesting thing that they discovered in that time, which was 1 in 20 commuters changed their route even after the tube reopened from what their normal day-to-day route on the tube was.
Really?
Which you would think, they must have it figured out. They must already have the efficient commute before the strike, because they're taking that every day. But with the strike, that added disruption, which enabled them to jump out of the box and say, okay, is there something more efficient I could be doing? And they found one, and they kept doing it after that strike.
So that inconvenient situation forced them to go a different route, which they then found out was actually faster than their original route. Interesting.
Right. Those are the kind of things you can find when you allow a certain amount of disruption in that's surprising, but you can't plan for it because it's random if you'll find it.
So it's like, you know, it's like the saying, don't, if it's not broke, don't fix it. Well, a lot of times there's so many things, so many ways to do something better that we wouldn't know because it takes too much energy and effort to change your current routine. And the current thing that we do, I mean, I also have lots of, you know, routines or unconscious things about how I always do something the same way. And I'm sure if things, a situation happened, or if I forced myself to think of a new way to do it, you know, think of a different way to do it, even though it'd be a little bit uncomfortable, I'd probably find a lot, some way better ways to do things that are different from how I normally do them.
So disruption probably would helps with that kind of thing. Also, remember that book Flow we read a while back that was like, when you have the intersection of skill and challenge, you're in your best state of flow. I wonder if when you're in flow, if you're more likely to find creativity as well, because it's a disruption from your normal balance of, you know, like too much skill or too much challenge, like you're right in the middle of it and in the thick of both to your max. Like the challenge gives you disruption, the skill gives you the order you're used to, and if you match that skill with that challenge, it's matching the disruption with the order.
Right.
It's probably a similar idea.
I think it's just the classic thing of order and chaos. If you're like right in the middle, you know, theoretically, and right in the middle of order and chaos.
Be there.
Exactly.
Perfectly.
Nobody can. But like, if you can be organized in some ways and chaotic in other ways, and combine that, that is when you probably are in that state of flow and you're the most creative, yet the most efficient. Because what will happen is, with me and also my business partner, we're the same way. We will constantly be distracted, you know, or messy in everything. Kind of like, we'll just like, oh, let's do this. Let's jump to this. we start something,
uh-huh.
and then we're like, oh, let's do this. We found something better. And we're like doing that all day. So it's like sometimes we barely get anything done because we're constantly being, you know, quote unquote creative. But that also causes some big problems. It's like we're trying. It's just so hard for us to stay on one thing at a time and plan. And it's like we just want to be surprised all the time. So whatever we can do to be distracted and be surprised is what we want to do the most.
Or flipping that around, it's like having the ability to be flexible. It's like versus being inflexible, versus being you won't move at all. Like I think about when you're improvising, that is the maximum state of messiness slash, you know, order or the skill and challenge.
You can be too much either way. You know, you can be too flexible, I think, is a good point that people don't realize.
But
people are too flexible, too movable, too just whatever goes, you know. If you can combine that, if you can combine some structure, and I think in a way it's kind of like if you could do it right, you would plan to be spontaneous, which isn't really, it's kind of a contradiction. But in a way, I think if you could learn how to do that, where you would plan, you know, what you're going to do, your plan, and then you would intentionally leave spaces to come up with ideas, or, you know, if that's possible, you know. But I guess that's not being truly spontaneous, you know. But I think there's some way you could do that. That would be very efficient.
Well, you could probably be spontaneous with some structure,
right?
If you're willing to take risks and let go, which are both uncomfortable things to do, taking risks and letting go.
Yeah.
But it leaves it slightly messy so that there's room for improv, which is really cool.
That's a really good point. Taking risks. I think that is in a way like being messy, or it's like not knowing what you'll expect, you know?
So one way you take risks is when you're driving. And what's interesting is there was a Dutch traffic engineer who came up with a way to solve speedy traffic problems in the city. And what he did was he used the square about. Now, what that meant was making a intersection that's not a roundabout, it's a square about. So completely open in the center, gets rid of all the crosswalks, gets rid of all the traffic lights. What this did was got rid of the rules that made people want to cut corners and be dangerous, and made everyone feel an element of risk as they go through the intersection. People, bikes, and cars alike felt this risk. What's interesting is that riskiness they felt actually increased the safety of the intersection because there was no rules to how you do the intersection. So everybody's watching out for each other, unlike, you know, assuming everyone else is following the rules and just being on autopilot.
Right. I love roundabouts. Like, I don't know why they don't have more of them. I think my dad always talked about how great they were. It's so much faster and so much more efficient. But, you know, they take up space. But, like, why don't they have more of those instead of stoplights? Like, they work so well.
And you have to be alert when you're at those, which is the trade-off.
Right,
because
right.
You're watching for, is that car that's in the intersection, does he have the right-of-way right now based on, like, where he's going? Well, what that does is increases your alertness versus pulling up to a traffic light and just mindlessly sitting there waiting for it to turn green.
Right.
It's a very different level of alertness.
Yeah. It's a totally different way of doing something that seems very chaotic, but I think they're pretty safe as far as I know. Like they're plenty safe, but they're way, way faster, way, way more efficient. I think the only downside is they take up too much space, but, and you have to be more alert, but that's a good example of something, yeah.
What's interesting about the whole concept of like a roundabout or a square about is it gets rid of the digital automation, so what digital automation does is it tidies up your small errors, the book was saying. It takes care of the small things for you.
Like a stoplight?
In the process, like a stoplight is tidying up the small errors of, hey, you weren't looking. Well, you don't have to look anymore. You just look at the light and then you go. Well, that opens the door for much bigger errors because you're not being alert. The light turns green and then the guy zips through on a red light and it's not a good situation in that intersection. Well, the book brought up how with Air France, there was this crash that happened due to a stall that the pilots could have prevented, but the system they were flying with, it was going haywire, and they kept pulling back thinking they had to climb, but the system kept saying they were stalling, and they didn't realize what was going on because they were flying with the autopilot and it had a slight malfunction that day. If they had realized it was malfunctioning sooner, they could have prevented a crash into the ocean, but they were seconds late in assessing the situation and recovering from the stall. The thing is, you could get complacent unless you give people small messes or challenges to keep them active all the time. Like a roundabout keeps you active thinking about who's in the intersection, who should I be watching for, versus a light, you're not active. You're just watching for it to turn green. It's like the opposite of active.
It's like they say, like pilots who fly by the seat of their pants are actually, or, you know, you want to be able to do both, right? You want to be able to
do the instruments,
and also just, you know, you should be able to fly with no instruments and just by the seat of your pants. And those are the most skilled pilots. And it's like when we try to, you know, like all the modern systems with the new planes where everything's on autopilot and everything happens automatically. That's great, and I'm all for that automation, but that can cause problems.
Right. So this book gave me a new appreciation for messiness that I did not have. It's amazing what you can do with a slightly messy life, as this book puts it, that can get you to the next level because you're willing to let down your guard, not be completely organized, and in that way, you can harness opportunities that come in ways you don't expect, which, you know, in another book we were talking about, with networking, you know, the weak ties of networking are the strongest ties in some sense for your future, for where you can go. It's kind of the same concept because weak ties is a messy business. You haven't talked to this person in a year plus, and this is your chance to, you know, have a slightly chaotic conversation because you don't know much about them after all. But then they have the greatest keys to your future.
Yeah, exactly. Being forced into situations like that is what causes you to grow. And that's a good point.
Yeah.
Like the chaotic, the new environment, you know, what makes us uncomfortable is what makes us stronger when we have to push through that. But that's awesome.
Yeah.
Like, I was even just thinking about this because I'm recording this podcast while I'm driving. Excuse the poor sound quality. But I feel like I'm able to be more creative and think better when I'm driving, you know, or when I'm in a new environment than when I'm normally just in my office recording the podcast. And, you know, I feel that a lot of times when I'm in a new environment, I can be, you know, more creative. So, you know, Yeah,
it's like one of the best ways to stay focused is switch things up sometimes because that keeps you on your game and your brain's like, oh, this isn't normal. All right, I'm not going to act normally. I'm going to act in my flow state if you set the environment up that way.
Wow.
That's the potential messiness has.
Very interesting. Right. Yeah, definitely.
So we hope you enjoyed this book like we did. If you want to hear more like this, please tap subscribe and you won't miss any action on the podcast. We also love your feedback on books that you want to hear. We'd love to get some more responses on the survey. We've had maybe one or two lately, but we need to kick this up a notch. So if you have a book you want us to feature, make sure you send it into our survey at motivationminute.com. We'd love to have you on to come talk about it.
And we'd also appreciate if you left a review on iTunes. Leave a positive review on there. That would help us out.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Well, thanks guys for listening, and we'll see you next time.